ओरल कैविटी. द ओरल कैविटी इज डिवाइडेड इंटू द वेस्टिब्यूल एंड द ओरल कैविटी प्रॉपर. द बाउंड्रीज ऑफ वेस्टिब्यूल आर आउटसाइड इट इज बाउंडेड बाय द लिप्स एंड द चीक्स एंड ऑन द इनसाइड इट इज बाउंडेड बाय द अपर एंड द लोअर जॉ विद इट्स गम्स एंड द टीथ. सो इट इज द स्पेस बिटवीन अवर टीथ और द जॉ एंड द चीक्स इज कॉल्ड द वेस्टिब्यूल ऑफ द माउथ. Whereas the oral cavity proper is bounded anteriorly by the alveolar processes, that is having the gums and the teeth, the upper and lower jaw, behind by the oropharyngeal isthmus. The boundaries of oropharyngeal isthmus are above, it has the soft palate, below it has the tongue, the posterior one-third, and on each side by the palatoglossal arch. The roof of oral cavity is formed by the palate, which is made up of hard palate and a soft palate. The floor is formed by diaphragma oris, which is a oral diaphragm formed by the mylohyoid muscle of both the sides. The tongue, beneath the tongue is the frenulum linguae, which is a fold which connects the tongue with the floor of the oral cavity. By the side of it there is a sublingual papilla on which there is the opening of the submandibular duct, and from the papilla there is a sublingual fold where the sublingual ducts open. So these are the boundaries of the hard palate. As seen from the oral cavity, it forms the roof of the oral cavity. If we see from below, it shows anteriorly it is formed by the perpendicular plate of the palatine bones here. Sorry, perpendicular plates of the maxilla, and these are the horizontal plates of the palatine bone. So the hard palate is formed by maxilla and palatine bones, anteriorly perpendicular plates of the maxilla, posteriorly horizontal plates of the palatine bones. These two meet at a cross-like suture, which is called the cruciform suture. Here, which is anterior part of the suture is intermaxillary suture. Posterior part of the suture is interpalatine suture, and between maxilla and palate is the palatomaxillary suture. Now, coming to the soft palate, the competency is 36.1, where you should know to describe the composition of the soft palate. Now, this is the hard palate here, and posteriorly attached to the hard palate. So if we see the hard palate, there is a palatine crest which is seen here, elevation on the hard palate. So attached to those palatine crest, there is a palatine aponeurosis, and extending from the posterior border of the hard palate and up, extending up to the palatine crest, is the attachment of the soft palate. So this whole thing is the soft palate, which is a muscular, fibro and glandular. It is made up of fibro, muscular and glandular structure, a flap like structure which is attached to the posterior end of the hard palate. This is soft palate. So soft palate we will describe under the following heads: the introduction, then its formation, the muscles forming the soft palate, the nerve supply, blood supply, and some applied part. So the introduction is, it is a fibromuscular glandular curtain covered by mucous membrane, hangs from the posterior border of the hard palate. It divides the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. So if this is the nose, this is the mouth. This is the hard palate, and this is the fibromuscular curtain. This is the tongue in the oral cavity. So this is the soft palate, which divides. This is nasal cavity, and behind it is the nasopharynx. So this part is the nasopharynx, and this part is the oropharynx. So it divides the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. If we see from the oral side, this is hard palate, and continuing posteriorly is the soft palate. We can see small ducts. So there are some glands which are called palatine glands, and the ducts of these glands open on the oral side of the soft palate. Now the presenting parts. So we have seen that the soft palate is a fibromuscular and glandular curtain that hangs attached to the posterior border of the hard palate, and it hangs like this and divides the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. So what are the, when it is relaxed state, there are two surfaces. So this facing to the oral cavity becomes anterior surface, and facing to the nasal cavity or nasopharynx becomes the posterior surface. The anterior surface is concave and shows a median raphe. The posterior surface is convex. Then there is a superior border, this one, which is attached to the hard palate, and there is an inferior border which is free, and it shows the a conical projection called the uvula. And from this inferior border, there are two folds or arches which extend to the tongue on either side. So if we see the soft palate like this, and here in the floor of the mouth is the tongue. This is posterior surface of the tongue. So from the palate going to the tongue, this is one arch that is called the palatoglossal arch. And from the palate going to the pharynx is a palatopharyngeal arch. So there are two arches, and there is a enclosing between these two arches, a fossa called the tonsillar fossa. So this inferior border of the soft palate is related to two arches, palatopharyngeal and palatoglossal. The lateral borders form the wall of the pharynx. When stretched, it has just two surfaces, that is, so if the same thing becomes stretched like this, it will have one superior surface and one inferior surface. So these are the presenting parts of soft palate. Now the composition, it is, as we said, it is fibromuscular and glandular and covered by mucous membrane. So all these structures will be present in the composition. Anterior one third of soft palate is fibrous, which is formed by the palatine aponeurosis derived from the tendon of tensor veli palatini. The muscle, when it comes towards the soft palate, forms a flattened tendon for insertion, and that is called the aponeurosis, which is attached to the posterior border of hard palate extending up to the palatine crest. The middle one third of soft palate is formed by five pair of muscles, which we will see, vessels and the nerves. Posterior one third is glandular. It is formed by the palatine glands. Anterior one third is fibrous, middle one third is muscular, and posterior one third is glandular. The mucous membrane covers the palate, but the oral side of the palate is lined by oral like epithelium, that is stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. Only the posterior aspect, which is facing the nasopharynx, in its upper part is lined by ciliated columnar epithelium. A Passavent's ridge is a transition of or the junction of this squamous and the columnar epithelium, and this is the ridge which comes in contact with the pharynx where the palate and the pharynx come in contact. Coming to the muscles of soft palate, there are 5 pairs of muscles. The first muscle is levator veli palatini. Now, this is a diagram which is showing apex of petrous temporal bone. So, as we look at the base of the skull, norma basalis, we can see apex of petrous temporal. Anteriorly and laterally to this apex, there is a cartilaginous part of auditory tube, this green one. Now, the origin of levator veli palatini is from the apex of petrous temporal bone in front of the carotid canal, from the carotid sheath and the medial lamina. So, this part, the medial lamina of the cartilaginous part of auditory tube. The muscle passes downwards through the sinus of Morgagni, which is a space between the upper border of superior constrictor and the base of the skull. It inserts on the upper surface or posterior surface of the soft palate. Now, the muscles of both the sides come together and form a U-shaped sling. So, this is the U-shaped sling of levator veli palatini. Origin from the apex of petrous temporal, from medial aspect of cartilaginous tube and carotid sheath. It is inserted on in the palatine aponeurosis on its upper aspect and forms a U-shaped sling. The tensor veli palatini is the next muscle. The action of levator veli is, as its name suggests, is elevates the palate. The tensor veli palatini muscle, it arises from the scaphoid fossa of the medial pterygoid plate, which lies at the base of it, from the lateral fibrous lamina of the cartilaginous part of auditory tube, and from the sulcus tubi and spine of sphenoid. As it goes to for its insertion, it winds around the pterygoid hamulus of the medial pterygoid plate. So, this is the pterygoid hamulus. And then it forms a tendon which flattens and forms the palatine aponeurosis. This is the next muscle. The third muscle is musculus uvuli, which arises from the posterior nasal spine and the palatine aponeurosis. The muscle of either side is inserted into the submucous tissue at the base of the uvula. The palatopharyngeus muscle, this yellow color, it is the palatopharyngeus. As you can see, it arises by 2 heads from either side of the levator veli palatini. So, one anterior fasciculus arises from the hard palate and upper part of palatine aponeurosis anterior to levator veli palatini. The posterior fasciculus arises from the lower part of the palatine aponeurosis. These both of them meet together and form the palatopharyngeal arch, which descends and joins with the other 2 longitudinal muscles of the pharynx, and it is inserted into the posterior border of the lamina of the thyroid cartilage as a common conjoint sheet. It also spreads along the pharyngeal wall and inserted on the pharyngeal raphe. Now, this same muscle has a few fibers, the few fibers of palatopharyngeus muscle, which sweep backwards here and they form a passivant's ridge. So, from the soft palate, these fibers sweep backwards and form a U-shaped sling which connects this soft palate with the nasopharynx posteriorly, and these fibers are called the passivant's ridge. Then next muscle is palatoglossus, which arises from the under surface of the soft palate, this one, and is inserted on the lateral side of the or lateral border of the tongue at the junction of its anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3. This is the palatoglossal muscle, which runs in the palatoglossal arch. And these palatopharyngeal arch and palatoglossal arch, they bound the tonsillar fossa. Now, as you can see, these three muscles of the soft palate form three U-shaped slings. So, one is called the first sling, which is directed upwards, is formed by the levator veli palatini. The second sling, which is directed posteriorly towards the nasopharynx, is called the formed by the palatopharyngeus, called the Passavant's ridge. And the third, which is going downwards towards the tongue, is formed by the palatoglossus muscle. Now the actions, as their name suggests, levator veli palatini will elevate and tense the soft palate. Tensor veli palatini is the action is it will stretch as well as depress the soft palate, and it will close the oropharyngeal isthmus. Because it is coming from lateral side of the auditory tube, it is said to be dilator of the tube. Hence the other name of this is dilator tubi. The musculus uvulae pulls the uvula forwards, or if one sided musculus uvulae contracts, it pulls the uvula to the same side. The palatopharyngeus muscle, it elevates the larynx and the pharynx, and it closes the pharyngeal isthmus by approximating the palatopharyngeal arches as well as the soft palate with the nasopharynx through the Passavant's ridge. The palatoglossus, it elevates the tongue towards the soft palate to close the oropharyngeal isthmus. These are the muscles of the soft palate. So the same muscles, if you want to show diagrammatically, this is the diagram that is showing the posterior aperture of the nose, wherein you can see three conchae in the nose. So this is the superior concha, middle concha, inferior concha. Here there is petrous temporal bone on either side. Here there is cartilaginous part of auditory tube as it goes and opens in the nasopharynx while it is going. Then on either side there is this is the medial pterygoid plate with its pterygoid hamulus, and this is the lateral pterygoid plate. Now this attached to the posterior border of the hard palate is the soft palate. So it is like this with the musculus uvulae. Now the first muscle is levator veli palatini, coming from medial side of auditory tube, petrous temporal, and it forms a sling like this on either side. The second muscle is tensor veli palatini, coming from the lateral side of the auditory tube, from the sulcus tubi scaphoid fossa. It forms a tendon which winds around the pterygoid hamulus, and it comes and forms a flattened aponeurosis within the soft palate. The third muscle is the palatopharyngeus, which has two laminae, two fascicles. One coming from anterior fascicle, anterior side of levator, one coming from the posterior side. And the palatoglossus, which comes from the under surface of the soft palate. So these are the muscles of the soft palate. Same thing is shown here. Here is the levator veli palatini. Here this is removed to show the tensor veli palatini. And this is musculus uvulae. This is the palatine aponeurosis. This is palatopharyngeus. The structure of soft palate, as we can see from above downwards, if you go arrangement of structures is mucous membrane of the nose, then a layer of glands, then the two muscles levator veli palatini and the palatopharyngeus, then the aponeurosis of tensor veli palatini plus musculus uvulae. From under surface is the palatoglossus origin, again layer of palatine glands and mucous membrane of the oral side. The nerve supply of soft palate has a motor supply. So all muscles are supplied by cranial part of accessory nerve through the pharyngeal plexus, except the tensor velar palatini, which is supplied by the mandibular nerve through the nerve to medial pterygoid. The general sensory supply is through the greater lesser palatine nerves, which are branches of maxillary nerve coming from the pterygopalatine ganglia and the glossopharyngeal nerve. Then there is also a special sensory, and that is taste sensation and secretomotor pathway. So this is for taste sensation. You start at the palate, that is the nerves are lesser palatine, and you go through the ganglion. It is carried towards the brain, that is to the nucleus of tractus solitarius. Secretomotor pathways, you start at the brain, that is in the nucleus in the pons, which is the superior salivary nucleus. You go through the nerves, then to the ganglion, and then up to the palate. So the taste sensation is carried from palate to the nucleus, and the secretomotor pathway is carried from the nucleus to the palatine glands to stimulate the secretion of the palate. And if you see the nerves, this pathway is exactly the opposite of this, only the nucleus is different. So here there is lesser palatine, they start from lesser palatine, here they end at lesser palatine. Then anterior palatine, then the pterygopalatine ganglion, the pterygopalatine relay, the nerve of pterygoid canal, the nerve of pterygoid canal, so on, so forth. The blood supply, arteries are the greater palatine branch of maxillary artery, ascending palatine branch of facial, and palatine branches of the ascending pharyngeal arteries. Veins drain into pharyngeal plexus via tonsillar plexus, and the lymphatics go to retropharyngeal and upper deep cervical lymph nodes. The functions are, it controls two gates, that is a pharyngeal isthmus, which is the airway, and the oropharyngeal isthmus, that is the food way. It helps in chewing by isolating the mouth from the pharynx so that breathing is unaffected. It also helps in the second stage of deglutition by separating the oropharynx from nasopharynx by locking the passavent's ridge so that food does not enter into the airway. It maintains the quality of voice as well as the speech. It allows the blowing of air through the mouth by closing the nasal cavity. Also, it allows while sneezing or coughing, the blast of the air is divided equally between the mouth and the nose. Coming to applied anatomy, there are many developmental or congenital anomalies like cleft palate. Various degrees of cleft palate we have seen in embryology. Paralysis of the soft palate can occur due to damage to the vagus nerve or after infection like diphtheria. When there is paralysis, there may be nasal regurgitation of liquids, there is a nasal twang to the voice, there is flattening of the palatal arch and deviation of uvula to the normal side. There can be choking by food due to laryngeal obstruction. Sometimes while eating in haste, if you suddenly talk or laugh, there may be, the food may go into the larynx. Now, in order to remove this, because it may suddenly obstruct the airway and lead to even death of the patient, there is a maneuver called Hemlich's maneuver, wherein you put pressure on the patient's upper abdomen and ask him to cough, or you press, sudden expiration will allow the dislodgement of the foreign body. For this, you can watch this YouTube video. Thank you.